see that spectrum of disorder of development of FIB, which presents in different forms at different ages. American Academy of Pediatrics, they have said developmental dysplasia of FIB as the femoral head, it has an abnormal relationship to the acetabulum. So what is the common etiology is basically an excessive laxity of the hip capsule, which causes this DDH. It fails to maintain the femoral head within the acetabulum. So we need to know certain terminologies regarding the DDH. The first one will be subluxation. As everyone knows, the femoral head will not be in full contact with the acetabulum. That is very important, full contact. The other features which will be present in subluxation are, there will be a widened teardrop and femoral head distance. The distance between the teardrop and femoral head, if you measure, it will be widened compared to the opposite side. There will be a reduced central edge angle. This will be dealt later. Just know what it is. In the subluxation, there will be a reduced central edge angle. There will be a break in Shenton's line. So if you go to dislocation, the femoral head is not in contact with the acetabulum. So previously we told it as not in full contact, that is subluxation. In dislocation, femoral head is not at all in contact with the acetabulum. That's the difference between the subluxation and dislocation. And the third one is dysplasia. Dysplasia is purely a radiographic finding where you will have an increased obliquity of the acetabular roof. So the acetabular roof, when you see which is convex, will be having an increased obliquity. The concavity will be lost. There will be an excessive lateral inclination of the roof of the acetabulum, which defines the dysplasia. Also, the other changes which you can see in dysplasia will be a widened teardrop, and that will be dealt later. Also, you can see the Shenton's line will be maintained in a dysplastic hip. Only in case of dislocation and subluxation, you will have a break in Shenton's line. So now we'll move on to the history. History starts from 1832. Guillaume Dupuytren was the first person who described congenital dislocation of hip. So earlier it was termed as congenital dislocation of hip. And in the late 1960s, the terminology changed into developmental dysplasia of hip. So the person, the image of this person is nothing but he is Adolf Lorenz. He is the father of avascular necrosis. To tell about him, he reduced the hips very vigorously such that most of the hips went for avascular necrosis. That is why he was very famous. He was called as the father of avascular necrosis. He is Adolf Lorenz. The other persons who contributed to the avascular necrosis, DDH were, one is Putti. Regarding Putti, he recommended early treatment of DDH, that is before 1 year of age. The other persons were Lee Dameny. Lee Dameny is the first person to describe the diagnostic sign of DDH, which we say as a jump sign or jerk sign, or in his French term, it is called a signe de ressort. He was the first person to tell about the diagnostic criteria, which is the diagnostic sign, jump sign. Following him, Ortolani described the Ortolani test or Ortolani sign or click test, click off entry, click off exit. And followed by Arnold Pavlik. Everyone knows about Pavlik harness. He was a person who found that Pavlik harness, which is revolutionized the treatment of DDH in neonates and infants. Next, we'll move on to the incidence. The incidence of DDH is 1.4 per 1,000 births. When we keep the clinical finding as a screening criteria, it is still more, which is 2.3 per 100 births. And if you include ultrasonic findings, ultrasound USG findings, along with the clinical findings as the screening criteria for identifying DDH, it is around 8 per 100 births. So we'll move on to the etiology now. The most common reason for DDH is ligamentous laxity. So ligamentous laxity was found to be inherited. Actually, the person who found this was Winnie Davis. So Winnie Davis, in her paper, she told that it is inherited. Mostly it is an autosomal dominant disorder with an incomplete penetrance. So you know about Winnie Davis. Winnie Davis defined the Winnie Davis criteria to assess the ligamentous laxity in newborn. And this criteria has five components. The first component is, as you can see in the picture, flexion of thumb as it touches the palmar aspect of the forearm, volar aspect of the forearm. The second criteria will be extension of the fingers, which becomes parallel to the dorsal aspect of the forearm. The third criteria will be extension of elbow of more than 15 degrees. And the fourth criteria will be extension of knee of more than 15 degrees. The fifth criteria will be dorsiflexion of ankle of more than 60 degrees. So this is the criteria which Winnie Davis described to find the ligamentous laxity in a child. So the other points regarding the ligamentous laxity is that identical twins are more prone for DDH than fraternal twins, where the incidence is around 34% for identical twins than for the fraternal twins, where it is only 3%. Girls are most commonly affected than boys, and the reason for this has been given as child. We know that maternal relaxin hormone, which is given for dilatation of the pelvis, that crosses the placenta and it reaches the baby. And if it reaches a girl baby, she will have a predilection for this ligamentous laxity for DDH. So that is why girls are more prone for DDH than boys. And the other reason is collagen 3 is found more than collagen 1 in DDH patients. Then certain prenatal positions predisposed to DDH. They are breech, in which the breech is classified as double breech, single breech with a foot link, and frank breech with a knee extended. You can see the pictures here. With the double breech having a low incidence, single breech with the foot link, it has a 2% incidence, and frank breech with the knee extended, it will have 20% incidence of DDH. The other reason is the intrauterine positioning of the fetus, where a crowding effect is created within the intrauterine, within the maternal pelvis. This crowding effect causes the development of DDH, and most commonly because the fetal position is like with the left hip, which is hitting against the maternal sacrum. In this position only normally the fetus lies. So that is the reason why even the left hip is more commonly affected than the right hip. And it is more commonly seen in a firstborn child with a history of oligohydramnios, also with a history of hyperthyroidism. Torticollis and metatarsus adductus has a close relevance with the DDH. So people with the torticollis have 15% chance of having DDH, and people with metatarsus adductus have 10% chance of having DDH. Then we move on to the postnatal positioning, which is the third common cause for DDH. In peoples like Native Americans and Laplanders, what they used to do is, instead of our method of putting the hip is getting abducted in the diaper, they are not using that position. They are keeping the child with the hips in full extension against the normal hip flexion contracture. That is the method they use to cradle the babies. So because of that, DDH incidence was more among the Native Americans and Laplanders. As I said before, the racial predilection, the whites and Native Americans and Laplanders, they had 15 DDH per 1,000 births. But when you compare to the blacks and Asians, they have only 0.1 to 5 per 5 childs per 1,000 births. So the etiology gets over here. Now we'll move on to the normal hip development so that we can understand what is the pathology happening. So normal hip development, when we see, it starts at the 7th week of gestation. The hip begins to develop only at the 7th week. You can see the picture here. A cleft will appear in the 7th week of gestation in the mesenchyme of the primitive limb. But this is the cleft which is appearing. And that cleft divides, and the lower one will become the femoral head and the upper one will become the acetabulum. So we say that this is the 11th week picture, where the precartilaginous cells differentiate into a cartilaginous femoral head and cartilaginous acetabulum. You can see that the cleft is there, the femoral head is appearing and the acetabulum is appearing. This is the 11th week picture. So when the femoral lead is maintained within the acetabulum during the intrauterine life, the concavity of the concave shape of the acetabulum properly develops. So if there is any failure during this normal embryogenesis period, any insult to the developing fetus at the limb buds, you will have a major anomaly which is not related to this topic. You should know that there is proximal femoral focal deficiency. That will happen if a major insult occurs during the normal embryogenesis of it. See, DDH is something which happens after the embryogenesis. The insult happens after the embryogenesis, after the fetus comes out. So what happens at birth? You can see the picture here. At birth, the neonatal acetabulum is completely cartilaginous. You can see three lines being drawn representing ileum, ischium and pubis. This is the cartilaginous acetabulum at birth, completely cartilaginous. And this cartilaginous acetabulum, to increase the depth of the cartilaginous acetabulum, we will have a labrum. Just a minute. Okay. We'll have the labrum here. You can see the dark triangular shaped labrum. This labrum tries to increase the depth of the acetabulum. It increases the depth of the acetabulum and accommodates the femoral head. So you can see the cartilaginous acetabulum here. And this is the hyaline cartilage. This is the fibrocartilage. Fibrocartilage. Sir, is the cursor visible, sir?
Visible. கொஞ்சம் சின்னதா இருக்கு, விசிபிளா இருக்கு, விசிபிளா இருக்கு. அது டாப் ரைட்ல தானே இருக்கு, அந்த செகண்ட் பிக்சர்ல.
ஆ, செகண்ட் பிக்சர் சார்.
ஆ, வருது 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 வருது.
ஓகே. சோ திஸ் இஸ் தி லேப்ரம். லேப்ரம் இஸ் மேட் அப் ஆஃப் ஃபைப்ரோ கார்டிலேஜ் அண்ட் திஸ் இஸ் தி அசிடாபுலம் which is made up of a hyaline cartilage. And this acetabulum the acetabulum meets the bony acetabulum at the triradiate cartilage. This hyaline cartilage acetabulum meets the bony acetabulum at the triradiate cartilage. A picture which is given below, this is the triradiate cartilage where you have three limbs of the cartilage, two horizontal limbs, one vertical limb. You can see two ossification centers at the junction. The above will be the ileum. This is the ischium. IS is represented as ischium. P is represented as pubis. So this is the hyaline cartilage. Okay, the surface of acetabulum, as you can see in this x-ray picture, you have a thin rim of epiphyseal cartilage which is responsible for the cartilaginous growth of the acetabulum. It is hemispherical in shape, and any insult to this epiphyseal cartilage, that is the periacetabular area, will definitely compromise the acetabular shape, the development of the acetabular shape. And majority of acetabular shape development is determined by 8 years of age. So we should be very careful while doing surgeries for young hips not to disturb the epiphyseal cartilage. And in the late adolescence, after the primary acetabulum is developed, the secondary acetabular centers which appear are the three, which is os acetabulum, which forms the anterior part of the acetabulum, anterior wall. It appears at the 8 years of age. Then you can see acetabulum, acetabular epiphysis, which appears in the superior edge of the acetabulum as a part of ileum. It forms at 8 years of age and it fuses at 18 years. And the other one is the small epiphysis, which represents the posterior ischial area. It forms at the 9 years of age and it fuses at 17 years. These are the secondary acetabular centers which develop later in the life. So moving on to the femoral part, the proximal femur, it has a complex growth pattern. The entire neonatal femur will be cartilaginous, representing the entire head, greater trochanter and lesser trochantic region. Everything will be a cartilaginous structure. It has two types of growth. One is the femoral head and the trochanter. It grows by the appositional growth. So the entire upper femur, it grows by the appositional growth, and the part below, that is the metaphyseal region, neck and the shaft, it grows by the epiphyseal growth. So So the ossification center for the femoral head, it appears between the 4th and the 7th week of life. It grows until the late adolescence, until the it will develop until the physeal closure is there. And as the child grows, what happens is that the femoral head, the thickness of the cartilage of the femoral head, it reduces, accommodating within the deep seating within the acetabulum. Both on the sides of acetabulum as the and the femoral head side, the thickness of the cartilage will get reduced as the age as the child grows. So now we'll go to the pathogenesis. After seeing the normal anatomy, we'll go to the pathogenesis, what is happening in DDH. So this is a picture representing a child, newborn child with an autopsy dissection is done and showing the entire pelvis with the acetabulum and the femoral region. So in DDH, what happens? The DDH is a gradually progressive disorder which occurs after birth. Every changes which occurs in DDH are reversible, mostly if we intervene earlier. So what happens is that there will be a malformation of anatomic structures that are developed normal during the embryogenesis. So this word is very important. There is a malformation of the anatomic structures which developed normal during the embryogenesis. So at birth, being the capsule being lax, what will happen is the femoral head will spontaneously, it will slide into and out of the acetabulum. And in DDH, particularly what happens is that when this femoral head slides within the and out of the acetabulum, the part which is mentioned here as T, you can see that T, D and R. So this is the hyaline cartilage of the acetabulum, sorry, the fibrocartilage of the acetabulum. As the femoral head slides in and out of the acetabulum, this will get flattened out. So this will get flattened out mainly over the posterosuperior acetabular rim area. It will get flattened out. And in one area, that is, you can see this posterior and the inferior area, you have a R, that is the ridge. That ridge is nothing but the neolimbus, which we learn. Neolimbus, which is very important in DDH. Neolimbus is the ridge. And this ridge is responsible for the Ortolani's clunk. So this ridge, as the femoral head moves inside and outside of the acetabulum along this ridge, you will hear that the palpable clunk which is elicited in the newborn DDH patients. So that is due to the thickening of the cartilage in one specific area. And if the hips are reduced, normally it get these changes will get accommodated and the depth of the acetabulum will form. If the hip is not getting reduced, certain secondary changes will appear. And those secondary changes are, there will be a thickened pulvinar fatty tissue in the depth of the acetabulum. The ligamentum teres will get thickened and will get elongated. The transverse acetabular ligament, which is a tall, it will be pulled up and it will be hypertrophic. And when we come to the capsule, there will be a hard glass constriction of the capsule because of the displacement of the femoral head out of the acetabulum. Mostly it will displace superiorly. So there will be a hard glass constriction of the acetabulum, and that is due to the iliopsoas tendon. That is also called as a Chinese finger trap. And the other changes in the femoral side will be because of the femoral head moving into and out, hitching against the thickened acetabular cartilage. There will be a flattening over the medial aspect of the femoral head. Also, sometimes there will be increase in antiversion. So these are the pathological changes which appear, which is pictorially represented. First is the normal lip. You can see the capsule and the normal attachment of the capsule. You can see this will be the labrum normally, which increases the depth of the acetabulum, and the femoral head is deeply seated. So in this subluxated lip, you can see the capsule is elastic. It is stretched, and the labrum, still it is everted, being a little hypertrophic. The normal shape of the femoral head is maintained in a subluxatable hip, and you can see the ligamentum teres getting elongated. When it comes to a dislocatable hip, so what happens is that still the labrum becomes hypertrophic and everted, and you can see some pulvinar fatty tissue being formed within the depth of the acetabulum starts forming. Capsule is becoming loose and stretched. Ligamentum teres still elongated. Once the hip is dislocated, the femoral head is out of the acetabulum, what will happen is that there will be full pulvinar fatty tissue formed within the depth of the acetabulum. And this arrow mark representing the labrum, actually the labrum is clear in the next picture. You can see here the blue one, which is the labrum forming the margin of the acetabulum, cartilage margin of the acetabulum, is inverted completely. It is getting inverted. You can see the ligamentum tear is elongated, pulvinar fatty tissue being accommodated within the depth of the acetabulum and the capsule. It forms an hourglass constriction due to the iliopsoas tendon. Also, you can have capsular adhesions occurring, in which will be very important when you deal with the open reduction to release these capsular adhesions. So this is a pictorial representation of hourglass constriction of capsule by the iliopsoas tendon. This is the iliopsoas muscle and this is the tendon which inserts over the lesser trochanter. The femoral head is getting subluxated, getting dislocated, and you can see a hourglass shape constriction of the capsule. And in this picture, you can see the acetabulum position where it is and femoral head where it is. This capsular constriction, this isthmus, it markedly reduces the acetabular orifice, which means that the femoral head, it prevents the femoral head from getting into the acetabulum. And this picture represents pelvifemoral muscles, which is nothing but the gluteus medius and minimus muscle getting shortened because of the proximal displacement of the femoral head. Also the iliopsoas muscle, it is getting shortened, and also the adductus, it is getting shortened because of the proximal migration of the femoral head. And something called as docking of head, this should be known. What is docking of head is that in the pathogenesis, if the femoral head, the femoral head can be reduced within the acetabulum, it can be either a stable reduction or an unstable reduction. When we come to this unstable reduction, this is something happens which is called as docking of head. What is it is that after the femoral head, which is being reduced within the acetabulum, the acetabular rim, which forms the deep socket for the acetabulum, the acetabular rim, it gets impeded between the femoral head and the acetabular hyaline cartilage. So this fibrocartilage, it gets impeded between the hyaline cartilage and the femoral head, and there will be an incomplete reduction of femoral head within the acetabulum. So the rim will become thicker as when the reduction is completed, and if you apply a cast with the femoral head being docked against the acetabulum, what will happen is that the rim will become thicker, and if the head is maintained within the acetabulum in this position itself, what will happen is that it will gradually remodel. The acetabulum gradually remodels, the thickened rim, it flattens out, and it allows the femoral head to sit deeply. So that happens in the docking of head. Nothing but the docking of head is also normal concept only. Docking of head can be allowed. What they say is that in a later date, the femoral head flattens out and the acetabulum remodels, and it allows the femoral head to sit deeply. And in this, the secondary ossification centers will appear prematurely to cover the femoral head. If the hip becomes dislocated, still apart from those secondary pathological changes which I told you, such as ligamentum teres elongation, pulvinar fatty tissue, apart from that, what are the other pathological changes which are happening is that the acetabular roof, it becomes progressively more oblique. The concavity of that acetabular roof, it becomes flattened, or it becomes even convex. The concave acetabulum will become a convex acetabulum. The medial wall of the acetabulum without the femoral head, it will get thickened, and it will become sometimes the acetabulum will become excessively antiverted. The whole of the pelvis also, it can get twisted medially. Also, regarding the teardrop will get thickened, and there will be an alteration in the teardrop shape. It will be dealt later, teardrop alone. And then the femoral head will stay dislocated, it will be superiorly dislocated. So what we call it as a high riding dislocation, usually seen in the late presentation of DDH. It will be usually seen in the late adolescents and adults, where you can see a dislocated femoral head lies well above the acetabular margin. The capsule will be thickened, and the femoral head, there will be a change in the shape of the femoral head, with femoral head becoming oval, or it is flattened medially. Acetabulum, usually it will be filled with the fibrous tissue and it will be having the ligamentum teres, which is hypertrophied, and the tal, which I said to you earlier, it will also be hypertrophied. The cartilage which is present, which is the hyaline cartilage, which is present within the acetabulum, it will be either atrophic or it will be completely absent. What we are dealing is with adolescent and adult group. And pelvifemoral muscles will get shortened. Sometimes it will become even horizontally oriented. And fully dislocated femoral head, usually it remains free of degenerative disease for many years, rather than subluxatable femoral head. So now we'll go on to the clinical features. As I told you before in the history, Lee Damani was the first person who originally described click of entry in the developmental dysplasia of hip. It was described in 1912, and he called it as signe de ressort. It is a French term which describes nothing but the jump sign or the jerk sign where the femoral head pops into the acetabulum. It is a palpable sensation, and Philander et al., he described this as a ridge phenomena, as the femoral head moves over the ridge and it enters the acetabulum. And now we'll go on to Ortolani's sign. Ortolani is very important regarding DDH. He is the only person who described the clunk sign. Actually, Lee Damani's description and Ortolani's description are almost the same, but Ortolani is more portrayed than Lee Damani. So Ortolani is Italian pediatrician. He described the jump sign as segno dello scoto. In this, the examiner, you can see the picture here. The examiner holds the thigh with the thumb and the index finger. The other three fingers will hold the trochanter. So it is a dislocated hip, and this dislocated hip is attempted to reduce. They are attempting to reduce the dislocated hip. And how we reduce it? We are going to abduct the hip. ABD, abduct the hip. So when you give a mild traction and if you abduct the hip, the femoral head will move over that ridge and it will enter the acetabulum. So this sign is called a segno dello scoto sign, or the jump sign, or the jerk sign, or the click of entry. So you are reducing the hip click of entry. So what are the prerequisites to elicit an Ortolani sign? You need to have a relaxed child. Either the child should be quite sleeping, or you can have the child on a feeding bottle. There should be an examination surface which is firm, warm, and reasonably quiet examination room. Even parents' lap is preferable to examine. The examiner should be well experienced in eliciting an Ortolani sign, because this is just a feel. It is a feel of the examination, not which you hear. It is a feel of the examination. It is a clunk as the femoral head slides into the acetabulum over the ridge. And in some texts, it is given as high-pitched snap is also heard. It is given in Lowell and Winter as a high-pitched snap, but you just remember it is the feel of the examination. The clunk. It is the reverse of Barlow's sign. So what did Barlow describe? Barlow described a subluxation of hip, or subluxating or dislocating the hip. He provocated the dislocation, and that provocation was done by adducting this. The examiner holds the thigh with the index finger and thumb, and he has the three fingers over the greater trochanter, and the examiner tries to adduct ADD, adduct and push the head posteriorly so that it gets dislocated. So it is a click of exit. Barlow sign is a click of exit. So what are the features which will be seen in an infant? When we see in an infant, these are the features which will be extra other than the neonate. There will be a limited abduction. As you can see, the affected hip, the abduction is only 40 degree, and on the unaffected hip, it is 80 degree. There will be a limited abduction in the side of the DDH. And you very well know what is Galizzi sign. The hip is flexed to 90 degree. You can see the level of both knees from the side. The affected side, you will have a little lower than the unaffected side. That is the Galizzi sign. Because of the femoral head is getting pushed posteriorly, there will be a limb length discrepancy. And you also can see there will be asymmetry of thigh folds. gluteal folds, popliteal crease on the affected side. Also, there may be an apparent shortening, that is limb length discrepancy, may be there in an DDH child. So, PGs, do you know how to test a bilateral case in DDH child? So, if it is unilateral, these features are seen. If it is bilateral, how to test it? So, you need to do a Clisic test. What is... I can mute it. You can mute it. Others can mute. So, what is Clisic test? So, Clisic test, you have the third finger over the greater trochanter, index finger over the anterior superior iliac spine. It is nothing but a shoemaker's line. You can just draw a line from greater trochanter passing through the anterior superior iliac spine towards the umbilicus. If there is a bilateral pathology, you see, normal is that the line just points the umbilicus. If it is a bilateral pathology, it will be a halfway between the umbilicus and the pubis area. The line will be just below the umbilicus. So that is how we identify it as a bilateral pathology. So what happens in a walking child? If it is unilateral, you will have a Trendelenburg gait or a abductor lurch because of the poor abductor pull. You can see the affected side, the abductor pull is very weak and the patient is leaning on the affected side. You will have a Trendelenburg sign and a Trendelenburg gait. If it is bilateral, the child may have a waddling gait. Also, you can see hip flexion contracture. As shown in this picture, there will be a excessive lordosis, hyperlordosis in the child. So now we'll move on to the investigations. So investigations, first is ultrasonography. So it gives the soft anatomy of the hip. The person who pioneered this ultrasonography was Graf. Graf pioneered the examination of hip by ultrasonography. It shows the relationship of femoral head with the acetabulum. Usually you take a lateral imaging where with the transducer placed over the greater trochanter as shown in the image. So this is the image which we will get. You will have the ileum. The exact image is given, it's compared. You will have the ileum with the bony acetabulum and the cartilaginous acetabulum accommodating the femoral head. This image you will be getting. So with this, we can draw three lines, which is the baseline, the acetabular roof line, and the inclination line. So the baseline is drawn along the ileum, acetabular roof line along the bony acetabulum, and inclination line along the cartilaginous acetabulum. So the baseline, the angle between the acetabular roof line and the baseline is the alpha angle. Inclination, the angle between the baseline and inclination line is the beta angle. And we should be very sure that alpha angle, normal alpha angle is, you should just remember this, is more than 60 degree. Beta angle should be less than 55 degrees. So anything which is more is acceptable in alpha angle. Anything which is less than 55 degree will be acceptable for beta angle. So based on this, Graf classified the DDH based on the ultrasonographic findings. And this is a standard classification which was given by Graf. It had four types. In this four types, the second type was further classified into type 2A, 2B, 2C and 2D. This is quite confusing. We can go for a simplified classification of Graf, where he defined it with four types. The alpha angle, which is more than 60 degree, and the beta angle less than 55 degree is type 1, which is normal. And you need not treat those babies. Just you need to follow them up. In type 2, the angle will be between 43 degree to 60 degree. You definitely need to memorize this. 43 degree is the lower limit. And in beta angle, it is between 55 to 77 degree. In these patients, there will be some acetabular deficiency where there will be a delayed ossification. And it is the surgeon who decides whether to observe or you can put him on a Pavlik harness. So the treatment is variable. When you go to stage 3, group 3, it will be less than 43 degree of alpha angle and more than 77 degree of beta angle, where the femoral head is popping out of the acetabulum. It is getting lateralized. So the subluxation has started. So you need to put him on a Pavlik harness. When you go to type 4, it is unmeasurable. The alpha angle is also, and the alpha angle and the beta angle both are unmeasurable because the femoral head has dislocated. So definitely you need to either do a closed reduction or you need to go for an open reduction and put them on a cast. That will be the treatment. Or if it is a child, you can reduce it and put them on a harness. And this line is very important. Any normal ultrasonography at 6 weeks of age does not guarantee a normal hip later in life. So what does that say is you need to re-examine the patient, you need to do an ultrasonography after 2 weeks, or you can repeat it after again 3 weeks or 6 weeks. You need to repeat it and find whether the hip is getting dislocated or it is remaining the same. So then we'll go on to the X-ray. In the standard anteroposterior view of the DDH child, we can draw few lines which are nothing but these three lines: Perkins line, Ilgenrenus line, and Shenton's line. So what is Perkins line? Perkins line is drawn along the lateral margin of the acetabulum. It is a vertical line which is drawn along the lateral margin of the acetabulum. Then the Ilgenrenus line, it is drawn through the triradiate cartilages. So both the triradiate cartilage you take, you draw a transverse line through the triradiate cartilage. It is the Ilgenrenus line. What is Shenton's line? Shenton's line is a line which starts from the LP. It curves up along the femoral neck. It connects with the inner margin of the pubis. This is the Shenton's line. So when you draw the Perkins line and Ilgenrenus line, it divides the hip joint into four parts, which is the upper inner, upper outer, lower inner, and lower outer. So what you need to see is, you need to see this medial beak over the femoral metaphysis, medial beak. So this medial beak should be in the lower inner quadrant of the acetabulum. That is the finding you have to see. If it is inside, then there is no subluxation or dislocation. If the medial beak is lying away from this Perkins, this line, so it is out, whether if it is lying in the lower outer quadrant, then it is subluxated or dislocated. The next thing you should know about is acetabular index. The acetabular index, how it is drawn? You draw a line along the lateral, along the acetabular surface. This is the first line which is drawn, and the second line is the Ilgenrenus line. So the angle between these two is acetabular index. You see here in the newborn, it is 27.5 degree. 6 months of age, it will be 23.5. 2 years, 20 degree. Upper limit is always 30 degrees. So it is better to remember it as 20 to 30, or you can remember easily as 25 degrees. See, all the angles which I'm telling hereafter will be around 20 to 25 degree only. So you better remember acetabular index as 25 degree. And anything which is above 30 degree of acetabular index is abnormal. The second one, the next one is the central lens angle of the Weber. This angle is obtained by drawing a line joining the lateral margin of the acetabulum with the center of the femoral edge. This is one line, and the other line will be the Perkins line. So the angle between these two lines is the central edge angle of the Weber. Usually after the femoral head appears, that is completely ossified femoral head, if you see, then only you can draw this central edge angle. So it is usually seen in 6 to 13 years of age. The normal angle will be around 19 degree, which you can easily remember as 20 degree, and 14 years and above, it will be 25 degree. So these measurements which comes in DDH is almost 20, 25, and in that range only. The next view is an Andren-Van Rossen view. So in this view, you can see both hips are abducted, internally rotated, and extended. The examiner is holding in that position, and an AP image is obtained. So what we have to do is, we have to draw a line along the femoral shaft. We have to see whether this line intersects the acetabulum. If it intersects, it is normal. If it is not intersecting, see in this picture, the line is away from the lateral margin of the acetabulum. It goes away. So this is dislocation. So this will be very helpful planning for the osteotomies, where you need a concentric reduction of hip. This Andren-Van Rossen view is very helpful. Then, as we said before about the acetabular teardrop, so now we'll study about the acetabular teardrop in DDH, what happens. See, normally, the acetabular teardrop, it appears at 6 to 24 months of age. In dislocated hip, this teardrop, it appears little late. It normally, you know, the acetabular teardrop, it is in the shape of the upper aspect of the teardrop will be narrow and lower will be little wide. So you know the teardrop. So what happens in a dislocated hip, this upper half which is narrow, that also becomes wider. It is not getting formed properly, this acetabulary error. So based on this also you can tell whether it is a dysplastic acetabulum or not. So the types of teardrop which is given are open, closed, crossed and reversed. As the name implies itself, we can understand what are the shapes of the teardrop. And I forgot to tell you, the teardrop is formed by medial wall of the acetabulum on the lateral side, inner pelvis on the medial side and the acetabular notch below. And the other types are U-type and V-type. In this V-type, if you see a V-shaped teardrop, definitely it is a dysplastic hip. And this teardrop, normally it appears when the hip is getting reduced and acetabulum, when it starts to remodel, this teardrop also appears. The other index which you should know is acetabular index of depth to width of the acetabulum. You draw two lines, one measuring the depth of the acetabulum, other the width of the acetabular opening. Then you calculate the acetabular index of the depth to width. Then the femoral head extrusion index, where the percentage of femoral head which lies outside the acetabulum can be calculated using this index. Finally, you will have a false profile view. What is this false profile view? This false profile view is used for evaluating the anterior acetabular dysplasia. So this anterior portion of acetabulum, how it is, we can determine using a false profile view. You ask the patient to lean against the cassette. You ask him to stand in a 65 degree oblique angle to lean against the pelvis. Should be, you can see in this image, the pelvis is at 65 degree to the cassette. I'm sorry, 65 degree to the X-ray beam. And the foot should be parallel to the cassette. That is also other recommendations here. Foot should be parallel to the cassette. And when you take an image, it will be like this. You can see the anterior acetabular wall. And with this anterior acetabular wall, you can draw a line along that to the femoral head and a vertical line over the vertical line joining the femoral edge center point. The angle between these two will give you a ventral central edge angle. So previously we saw just a central edge angle where you draw central edge angle where you draw angle between the Perkins line and the line joining the lateral margin of the acetabulum with the femoral edge. This is a ventral central edge angle. You should note that, where you make an angle between the anterior edge of the acetabulum and the central line. So this is normally 32.8 degrees. So when the ventral central edge angle gets reduced, there will be more of dysplastic acetabulum. And the point we should remember in this false profile view is a sorcil. The sorcil is nothing but the extent of, it represents the anterior coverage of the acetabulum. It is, when you see in the X-ray, you will see a dense line of ossification over the acetabular wall. That will be the sorcil. And regarding sorcil, in the treatment aspect, I will tell you it is more important in the osteotomies. So based on the central edge angle, Severin classified DDH into six types based on the radiographic appearance as well as the central edge angle. In the six types, the type 1 is further classified into A and B. Type 4 is further classified into A and B. So the normal central edge angle, we know it is around 20 degrees in 6 to 13 years, as well as more than or equal to 14 years. You can see it is 20 degrees. So you can see here 6 to 13 years, it is more than 19 degree. More than 14 years, it is 25 degree. The first type, the radiographic appearance is normal. It is 1A. If it is between the range of 15 to 19 degrees in 6 to 13 years, 20 to 25 degrees in more than 14 years, that is also acceptable and it is classified as normal. The type 2 will be the same range of central edge angle with a moderate deformity in the femoral head, femoral neck and acetabulum. So there will be a minimal changes in the acetabular side as well as femoral edge side. The deformity will be present. That is classified as type 2. When you go to type 3, the central edge angle is getting further reduced. It is less than 15 degrees in 6 to 13 years, less than 20 degrees in 14 years age group and above. So you will have a dysplasia in the X-ray, but a subluxation won't be present here. In type 3, you won't have a subluxation. When you go to type 4, subluxation starts. Type 4A is classified as moderate and type 4B is classified as a severe subluxation. And these values, you can see, it is severe subluxation, you have less than 0 degree of central edge angle. When you go to type 5, the femoral lead, it articulates with a pseudo-acetabulum. That is, the original acetabulum is present. A superior part of the original acetabulum, you will have the femoral lead articulating. That is type 5, classified as type 5. And type 6 is, you reduce the femoral lead and again, you have the femoral lead getting redislocated. That is classified as type 6. And finally, in the investigations, you have the arthrography. Arthrography, it was pioneered by Severin, as this classification was also given by Severin. Arthrography also was pioneered by Severin. The procedure is, you have a median subadductor approach. So you can see in this picture, adductor longus muscle. So this is the origin of adductor longus muscle. 2 centimeter distal to the origin of adductor longus muscle, beneath the adductor longus muscle, you have to insert the needle. And this needle should point towards the sternoclavicular joint of the contralateral side. So a bit medially, it has to point. So when you inject the dye, you will have this picture. You can see the x-ray here. You will have a whitish appearance after injecting the dye. That is the arthrography. You can see a triangular shaped structure. That is the labrum. It will be seen as a sharp thorn. Labrum will be seen as a sharp thorn, and from that you will have the recess of joint capsule appearing. And with this arthrography, always you find the, this usually is done during the close reduction. You find the place for position of maximum stability and instability using the C-arm. So when the hip is placed in, these findings are in the arthrography findings. When the hip is placed in the reduced position and an arthrography is done, the femoral lead is found fully reduced against the acetabular wall, and you can see the reduction is deep. Labrum, it lies flat over the femoral head. It will have a sharp border when it is fully reduced against the acetabular wall. But I said you previously about the docking against the acetabular wall. So that you should be seen in the arthrography. So docking against the labrum, what will be the other findings when it is docked? You will have a capsular constriction, labrum is blunted, the labrum gets interposed between the head and the acetabular wall. Ligamentum teres also, it will be found within the joint interrupting the deeply seated head of the femoral head. It will be outlined by the contrast. And you can see the bulge over the acetabular cartilage beneath the labrum, which is the neolimbus. And you have to, if the femoral lead is still maintained within that acetabulum, even if it is docked, you can maintain that femoral lead. And if the reduction is stable, you can immobilize the hip. And future, few days later, you can see the labrum will get flattened out. It will just have a deep-seated femoral head. It will cover the femoral lead well. And finally, we have the MRI in investigation. What are the features we can see in the MRI is that there will be a widening of the iliac bone. There will be a lateral drift of the superior and the posterior portion of the acetabular wall. And the acetabular cartilage, it will be overgrown. And if you see the acetabular cartilage posterior portion, there will be a convexity over the posterior portion of the acetabular cartilage. In MRI findings, based on MRI findings, Kashiwagi and associates, they gave a classification for the MRI findings in DDH. They classified into 3 groups. First group will have a sharp acetabular rim. Second group, rounded acetabular rim. In these 2 groups, if you put the patient in a pavlic harness, almost all the hips are reduced. When coming to the group 3, the acetabular rim was an inverted acetabular rim, as the image was shown previously in the barriers of secondary barriers of reduction. You saw the inverted acetabular rim. That will be a finding in group 3 patients where none were reduced by the pavlic harness. When you come to adolescent age group with hip dysplasia, MRI, plain MRI alone won't be enough. You need to have an MRI with the gadolinium contrast to be taken. You will see the labrum, how it is. So you can evaluate the labrum and the articular cartilage. You can see whether any disruption or tear is present in the labrum, any cartilage which is delaminated. Also, if it is lost, articular cartilage loss also can be seen in the MRI. So சோ தட்ஸ் ஆல் சார்
இல்ல உன்னோட ஸ்லைட்ல அந்த செவரன்ஸ் கிளாசிஃபிகேஷன்ல மாடரேட்ல வந்து யூ புட் மோர் தென் 20 டிகிரிஸ் அந்த ரைட்
சார் அது சார் ஐ வில் டெல் யூ சார் அது வந்து ஒரு சின்ன கன்ஃபியூஷன் இருக்கு சார் நார்மலா அந்த 6 டு 13 இயர்ஸ் ஏஜ் குரூப்ல வந்து லெஸ் தென் 15 டிகிரிஸ் அண்ட் மோர் தென் 14 இயர்ஸ் ஏஜ் குரூப்ல லெஸ் தென் 20 இயர்ஸ் அண்ட் 20 டிகிரின்னு கொடுத்திருந்தாங்க சார் அந்த பர்టిక్యులர் ஃபோர்த் டைப்ல வந்து மோர் தென்
ஒரே ஒரு Lesquin's Ashtabler Index.
Okay, sir.
It's got a name. அவ்வளவுதான். அது மட்டும் தான் எனக்கு தெரியும். மத்தபடி எவ்ரிதிங் இஸ் ஃபண்டாஸ்டிக். எனி க்வெஸ்சன்ஸ் ஆல்சோ ராம் பிரசாத் நீங்க என்ன உங்களுடைய இது
அந்த ஆத்தலோனி டெஸ்ட் வந்து எப்ப பண்றது? பார்லோ டெஸ்ட் எப்ப பண்றது? வாஸ் வான் ரோசன்ஸ் வியூன்னு சொன்னீங்களா அது எப்ப பண்றது? எந்த ஏஜ்ல பண்றதுன்னு எதுவும்
பார்லோஸ் அண்ட் ஆர்டலானி வந்து ரெண்டுமே வந்து ஆஃப்டர் பர்த் அட் பர்த் சார் நியோநேட் ஏஜ் குரூப்ல பண்றது சார் பார்லோஸ் டெஸ்ட் அண்ட் ஆர்டலானிஸ் டெஸ்ட் சார் ஆண்ட்ரன்ஸ் வான் ரோசன் வியூ வந்து ஈவன் அப் டு 2 இயர்ஸ் ஆஃப் ஏஜ் குரூப் வி கேன் டூ தட் சார் ஆண்ட்ரன்ஸ் வான் ரோசன் வியூ மெமரல் மெட்டாஃபைசிஸ் வந்து தி லைன் ட்ரான் அலாங் தி ஷாஃப்ட் இட் கட்ஸ் தி அசட்டாபுலமா இல்லையான்னு பாக்குறதுக்கு தான் சார் மெயினா அது அதுல வந்து ஹெட் இருக்காது சார் ஃபெமரல் ஹெட் வந்து இட் வில் நாட் பி கெட்டிங் ஆசிஃபைட் அந்த ஏஜ் குரூப்ல வி கேன் டிரா லைன் அலாங் தி ஃபெமரல் ஷாஃப்ட் விச் க்ரோஸ் த்ரூ தி ஃபெமரல் மெட்டாஃபைசிஸ் அண்ட் கட்ஸ் தி அசட்டாபுலம் அது பாக்குறதுக்காக தான் சார்
சோ இட் இஸ் அதாவது கட்டிஸ்ல ஃபெமரல் கேபிடல் எபிஃபைசிஸ் வந்து 6 மந்த்ஸ் ஆஃப் ஏஜ்ல தான் வந்து ஆசிஃபிகேஷன் ஆரம்பிக்குது சோ அந்த 6 மந்த்ஸ் ஆஃப் ஏஜ் வரைக்கும் நமக்கு வந்து வான் ரோசன்ஸ் வியூ வந்து it will indicate whether the head is inside the astabulum in capital inside the astabulum or outside the astabulum so after 6 months yes. Once the femoral epiphyse capital epiphyse is formed we don't need this one Rosen's view because the already the capital epiphyse is there and you can find out whether it is engaged in the astabulum or not so after 6 months in the absence of ossification of this capital femoral epiphyse we can use this one Rosen's view that is a 60 degree abduction and internal dissection in the under view அப்புறம் இன்னொன்று வந்து அந்த ஆர்த்தலோனிஸ் டெஸ்ட் வந்து டு பி ஸ்பெசிஃபிக் வந்து ஆர்த்தலோனிஸ் டெஸ்ட் வந்து 3 to 6 மந்த்ஸ் ஆஃப் ஏஜ் குரூப்பில் யூஸ்ஃபுல்லாக இருக்கும்னு போட்டிருக்கான் அதே மாதிரி பார்லோஸ் டெஸ்ட் வந்து அப் டு தி ஏஜ் ஆஃப் 6 மந்த்ஸ்ன்னு போட்டிருக்கான் இந்த இதில் போட்டிருக்கான் இந்த ட்ராக்ஷன் அண்ட் ஆர்த்தோபெடிக் அப்ளையன்சஸ் ஸ்டீவர்ட் ஸ்டீவர்ட்ல இப்போ தான் பார்த்தேன் அதாவது பார்லோஸ் வந்து நம்ம டெஸ்ட் ஆஃப் டிஸ்லொகேஷன் இல்லையா ஆமாம் பார்லோசன் டெஸ்ட் ஆஃப் டிஸ்லொகேஷனு அது வந்து அப் டு தி ஏஜ் ஆஃப் 6 மந்த்ஸ் பார்க்கலாம் அது என்ன ரீசன் சொல்கிறான்னா ஆஃப்டர் தி ஏஜ் ஆஃப் 6 மந்த்ஸ் அந்த ஃபீமர் வில் பிகம் இலாங்கேட்டட் க்ரோத் ஆயிரும் அதுக்கப்புறம் அந்த காலை பிடிச்சி டிஸ்லொகேட் பண்ணுறது கொஞ்சம் கஷ்டம் மாதிரி போட்டிருக்கான் இது வந்து ஆட்டோலோனிஸ் டெஸ்ட் வந்து டெஸ்ட் ஆஃப் ரிடக்ஷன் இட் இஸ் யூஸ்ஃபுல் பிட்வீன் தி ஏஜ் ஆஃப் 3 அண்ட் 9 மந்த்ஸ்னு போட்டிருக்கான் 3 அண்ட் 9 மந்த்ஸ் ஜஸ்ட் டு ஆட் அவ்வளோதான்
ஓகே சார் அது ஆக்சுவலி இந்த ட்ரீட்மெண்ட் ஆஸ்பெக்டில் பாப்லிக் கார்னஸ் பற்றி சொல்லும் போது பாப்லிக் கார்னஸ் வில் ஃபெயில் இன் கேசஸ் வேர் தெர் இஸ் ஆப்சன்ட் ஆர்டலானி அப்படின்னு சொல்லியிருக்காங்க சார் ஸோ மோஸ்ட்லி அப்போது 6 மந்த்ஸ் வரைக்கும் வந்து இட் வில் பி யூஸ்ஃபுல்லுன்னு நினைக்கிறேன் சார்
ஆர்டலானி ஆமாம் ஹார்லிக்ஸ் ஹார்னஸ் வந்து நம்ம நார்மலாக வந்து யூஸ்வலாக அப் டு 6 மந்த்ஸ் போடுவோம்
6 மந்த்ஸ்
அதனால இதுவும் அதே நீங்கள் சொன்ன மாதிரி ஆர்த்தோலோனிஸ் ரிடக்ஷன் ஆகுது அப்படின்னா பாப்லிக் ஹார்னஸும் வேலை செய்யும் அதே 3 to 9 மந்த்ஸ் நம்ம வந்து வச்சுக்கலாம் போல்றது
ஓகே சார்
அதரைஸ் நல்ல பிரசன்டேஷன் தான்
थैंक यू சார்
டிஸ்கஷிங் போர்லோ பார்லோஸ் அண்ட் ஆட்டலனி சம் மே கெட் கன்ஃபியூஷன் இது ஒரு நிமோனிக் தான் வாட் ஐ செட் டு தி அண்டர் கிராஜுவேட்ஸ் பார்லோ டெஸ்ட் வந்து நிமோனிக் இஸ் பேட் டேட் ஆட்டோலனி இஸ் ஓவர் அப் ஐ வில் எக்ஸ்பிளைன் சார் ஃபர்ஸ்ட் ஒன் இஸ் பார்லோ பார்லோ இஸ் பேட் டேட் யூ கேன் ரிமெம்பர் திஸ் நிமோனிக் பேட் டேட் பி ஃபார் பார்லோ ஏடி ஃபார் அடக்ஷன் D for dislocation, AD for adduction. So when you do bar low, by adducting the hip will go for dislocation. Dislocation is because of adduction. So thirumathirum adhe or adduction, adduction. The mnemonic is bad dad. Bar low, adduction, dislocation, adduction. Otolani is O-R-U-P. So first O-R, adhile vandhirudhu. So O stands for otolani, R stands for reduction, AB for adduction. So when you do abduction, it reduces. That is the mnemonic for autolani, ORAP. So it will be useful to you. I want to say that Hilgenreinness and Perkins line, what we draw in the hip. The mnemonic is H for Hilgenreinness, first letter. H for Hilgenreinness, that is horizontal line. Another H, horizontal line through the preradiate cartilage is the Hilgenreinness line. And the line perpendicular to Hilgenreinness, that is P. P for perpendicular, Perkins line along the lateral border of first abdomen. The thing is, normally the femoral epiphysis should be in the inner lower quadrant, normally. It is just opposite. If it is in the upper outer quadrant only, it is called dislocation. I think Manoj, you are just confused. You told lower outer quadrant. It is actually just opposite to inner lower quadrant is normal. Upper outer quadrant is dislocation. If it is here or here, it is subluxation. It is not dislocation. That is what I have read in the tag jar. What do you say, Manoj?
Sir, sir, this proximal metaphysis, you will be having a metaphyseal beak, sir.
Okay.
Metaphyseal beak, it should be within the lower inner quadrant.
Yes, that is normal.
Normal.
If it is just opposite, it is dislocation. If it is in the inner upper quadrant or lower outer quadrant, it is subluxation. This is normal, just opposite is dislocation. This point I want to mention. Another thing, that angle. The mnemonic is ரெண்டு ஆங்கிள் படிச்சிருக்கோம். சென்டர் எட்ஜ் ஆங்கிள் அஸ்டாப்லர் இண்டெக்ஸ். சென்டர் எட்ஜ் அதில் தான் டி வருது, இதில் டிஏ இல்லை. ஸோ டினா டிக்ரீசஸ். ஸோ சார் டோல்டு அந்த ஷெவரின் கிளாசிஃபிகேஷன், ஐ வாஸ் ஆல்சோ ஹேவிங் தி சேம் டவுட். டோல்ட் இட் வாஸ் மோர் தேன் 20 degrees ஒரே ஒரு இடத்துல, பட் இட் ஷுட் நாட் பி லைக் தட். ஆக்சுவலி ஷுட் டிக்ரீஸ். தட் இஸ் தி பை டெஃபினேஷன் ஃபார் டிடிஹெச், இட் ஷுட் டிக்ரீஸ். ஸோ சென்டர் எட்ஜ் யூ ஆர் கெட்டிங் டி ஹியர், இட் டிக்ரீசஸ். அஸ்டாப்லர் இண்டெக்ஸ் ஐஎன் இன்க்ரீசஸ். Index increases. So, இது வந்து 25 வச்சுக்கலாம். இட் இஸ் மோர் தென் 25-30 அஸ்டாபர் இண்டெக்ஸ், இட் ஹியர் இட் டிக்ரீசஸ். திஸ் ஐ வாண்ட் டு ஆட் சார். தேங்க் யூ சார், வெரி குட் பிரசன்டேஜ்.
டில் ஹவு மெனி மந்த்ஸ் அல்ட்ரா சவுண்ட் இஸ் ஆஃப் சிக்னிஃபிகன்ஸ் தென் வென் எக்ஸ்ரே சிக்னிஃபிகன்ஸ் சார்? பர்த் ஏஜ் சார், சம் கேட்டகரி, 6 months, 7 months ஆர் 4 months சம்திங்?
இல்ல, ஆக்சுவலி இஃப் யூ கோ, இஃப் யூ சீ அல்ட்ரா சவுண்ட், there is no, actually if you that is based on the treatment only, Kabilan. See, we are treating the child based on the clinical ultrasonographic and radiological findings only. So okay, when we see pelvic harness treatment, it is up to 6 months. The treatment for pelvic harness will be definitive treatment, means it will be up to 6 months. So up to 6 months, it will be useful if you take even a ultrasonography. Is just going to tell you what is the alpha angle and what is the beta angle. There is no it can be done till 6 months.
If at 3 months baby come, I have to take ultrasound only, sir? No need of x-ray, sir, or both, sir?
If you want to take an x-ray, as Ramprasad sir told, the only thing is that you won't have an ossified femoral lead. So you won't be able to see the femoral lead, whether it is the acetabulum is having a proper concentric reduction of the femoral lead. So that is why the concept of arthrography itself is coming there. So when we take the treatment aspect, after reducing the hip, we are going to do a arthrography and see. So that whether the the secondary barriers of reduction are still present, whether it is concentrically reduced or not, then only you are going to apply a cast. If you take as a radiography, mainly the false profile view at the age of 6 to 13 years, that will be useful in for determining the anterior edge of the acetabulum, that is the sorsal. You can take the false profile view. If you want to see the Hilgenreinness line and Perkins line at birth itself, if you want, you can take, there won't be a physis there. You can just see the medial beak of the proximal metaphysis. With that, you can identify whether it is inside or outside. And based on the acetabular index, you can check whether the concavity of the acetabulum is normal or not. So these are the things you can see. There is no particular age limit, I can tell you whether it can be taken only in birth or it can be taken in the 3 years or 6 months like that. One time you have one view, so you can't just tell them.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Is ultrasound useful in patients in children who are wearing this Pollux harness? That is, with the Pollux harness in situ,
yes,
can
sir.
We use ultrasound to find out, detect whether the hip is reduced or not?
Yes, sir.
I think it will be an answer for the posterior, the use of ultrasound.
Sir, definitely, ultrasound is ultrasound can be done in a patient with a Pollux harness, sir. When we find there is a dislocation or subluxation, we are putting child in a Pollux harness and we are examining at 3 weeks of time. After 3 weeks, we are examining again with an ultrasound. We are checking whether it is stable or unstable, sir. If it is stable, then again the patient is continued in a Pollux harness for another 6 weeks, sir. So definitely in a Pollux harness, we can do an ultrasound, sir.
So this is the answer for the previously asked question, I think.
Okay, sir.
Somebody asked whether ultrasound mean about X-ray and other things, you know. What is the use of ultrasound like that? So this is another use of ultrasound.
Okay, sir.
And one more, Manoj. என்னோட ஒரே ஒரு டவுட். See, இப்போ நம்ம வந்து we had இப்போ spine examination எடுக்கும்போது he mentioned about a lot of neurocutaneous markers, associated conditions. So does DDH have any on clinical examination? Does it have any neurocutaneous marker or are there any associated conditions like CTV la vandu spine examine pandrom? DDH la vandu is there any associated?
Only two conditions they have mentioned, sir. One is metatarsus adductus and another one is torticollis, sir. The torticollis patients will have 15% chance of developing DDH. Metatarsus adductus patients will have 10% chance of developing DDH, sir.
Other one is oligohedroneus, I think.
Oligohedroneus. That will cause an intrauterine crowding effect, sir.
அது இன்ட்ராயூட்ரைன் கிடையாது, போஸ்ட் யூட்ரைன் கேக்குறேன். நீ ஒலிகோஹெட்ரோனியஸ், யுவர் பெரினா பிரீச் பிரசன்டேஷன், எவ்ரிதிங் ஹஸ் காட் எ ப்ரீ டிஸ்போசிஷன் டு டிடிஹெச். நான் கேக்குறது வந்து அதர் கண்டிஷன்
அசோசியேட்டடா, இது ரெண்டு தான் சார் சொல்லிருக்காங்க, மெட்டாடாசஸ் அடக்டஸ் அண்ட் டார்டிகலஸ்.
ஓகேம்மா, எனி அதர் க்வெஸ்சன்ஸ்? மத்த இதுல இருந்து தெரியல எனக்கு, யாருமே தெரியல. பராசரன்
சார், ஒன் மோர் திங் சார், இன் டியூரிங் ஐசிஹெச் போஸ்டிங் சுரேஷ் பாபு சார் டோல்டு ஒன் ஆஃப் த கிளாசிபிகேஷன் சார், தட் இஸ் ஈவன் பிஃபோர் ஆசிஃபைட் நியூக்ளியஸ் தெர் இஸ் அ லேட்டஸ்ட் கிளாசிபிகேஷன் ஆஃப் ஐஹெச்டிஐ கிளாசிபிகேஷன் சார், பேஸ்ட் ஆன் எக்ஸ்ரே டு கிரேட் த டிடிஹெச் சார். ஈவன் பிஃபோர் ஆசிஃபைட் நியூக்ளியஸ் வி கேன் கிளாசிஃபை பேஸ்ட் ஆன் எக்ஸ்ரே சார், லேட்டஸ்ட் அடிஷன் சொல்லியிருந்தார் சார். சார்
இல்லை, நான் பார்க்கல சொல்ல.
அதான் சார், ஆக்சுவலி புக்ல இப்ப லேட்டஸ்டா போட்டிருக்காங்களா சார், அது ஐஹெச்டிஐ கிளாசிபிகேஷன், அது இந்த ஹில்கன் லைன் பிளஸ் பெர்கின்ஸ் லைன், அதை பேஸ் பண்ணி அந்த மெட்டாஃபேசிஸ் ஒரு பொசிஷன் வச்சு வருது சார். அது லேட்டஸ்டா சார் சொல்லியிருந்தாங்க சார், அதனால மட்டும் சொன்னேன்
சார். இல்ல மேபி சோட நீங்க ஃபைண்ட் இட் அவுட் அண்ட் புட் இட் இன் தி குரூப். சரியா?
ஆ, ஓகே சார், ஓகே சார்.
வரதன் சொல்ல, இது வரதன் டவுட் வந்திருக்கு.
ஆ, குட் ஈவினிங் சார். ஒண்ணுல சார், சார் அந்த இது கிளாசிஃபிகேஷன்ல சார், அந்த க்ரோவி கிளாசிஃபிகேஷன் இருக்குல, அதோட இம்பார்டன்ஸ் எது? இப்ப சார் அது மென்ஷன் பண்ணல சார், இஸ் இட் இம்பார்டன்ட் சார்?
I think that's a very good question. Crow's classification based on the THR kekkuravanga, dysplasia of acetabulum kekkura.
Adult DDH idhula include pannala sir, actually adu separate ah dhaan edukka mudiyum sir, idhuve konjam appa nariya irundhu sir, adanal adha.
Well, okay, I think that's a very good question, Vadarajan. Very nice question. இது வந்து மேபி யூ கேன் கோ அண்ட் ரீட் க்ரோஸ் கிளாசிபிகேஷன், படிச்சுக்கலாம், ஒன்றும் பெரிய கஷ்டமான விஷயம்லாம் ஒன்றும் கிடையாது. பட் ஆல் ட்ரீட்மெண்ட் இஸ் பேஸ்ட் ஆன் தி க்ரோஸ் தான். ராம்பிரசாத், நீங்க க்ரோ பத்தி ஏதாவது சொல்லணுமா? க்ரோ
கரெக்ட் தான், நீங்க சொல்றது கரெக்ட் தான். அதாவது when there is a high hip center, then the by policy we have to restore the hip center to the lower level. So that is our aim of the surgery, and as you said, in total hip replacement, the aim of surgery is to restore the bring down the hip center to original acetabulum, which will be found out intraoperatively with the help of pulmonary fat. Pulmonary fat will indicate the true acetabulum. So for that purpose, we may use this Crow's classification. Usually, these DDH patients, if they are left untreated, they grow into adulthood. They will develop this false acetabulum, which will be a pseudo acetabulum on the roof of the original acetabulum. So we may intraoperatively think that is the true acetabulum. We'll keep the cup there and come out. then we will find that we have kept the cup in the foul system. So in that cases, it's cross classification will be used.
வரதாஜன் பேஷன் மைட் பிரசன்ட் வெரி லேட் அன்னைக்கு கூட நான் மனோஜ் ஒரு எக்ஸ்ரே காமிச்சு ரெண்டு நாள் முன்னாடி ஒரு பேஷன் பார்த்தேன் பேஷன் இஸ் 35 ஆர் 38 இயர்ஸ் ஓல்டு பேஷன் கேம் வித் ஹிப் பெயின் ஆன் ஒன் சைடு அவர் வந்து எந்த கம்ப்ளைண்டுமே சொல்லல 3 டேஸ் பெயின் தான் சொல்றாரு எக்ஸாமின் பண்ணி பார்த்தா யூ வாண்ட் பிலீவ் போத் த ஹிப்ஸ் வந்து ஒரு 8 சென்டிமீட்டர் அசாப்ல வந்து வெளியில இருக்கு ரெண்டு ஹிப்போம் அவர் நான் நடக்கிறேன் ஓடுறேன் எல்லாம் சொல்றாரு அண்ட் ஐ பிரசன்ட் ஒன் கேஸ் இன் மேங்களூர் கோர்ஸ் அதுல வந்து சுதாகர் ஷெட்டி கிட்ட நான் பிரசன்ட் பண்ணேன் அது வந்து ஐ பிரசன்ட் இட் ஆர்த்ரைடிஸ் 45 இயர்ஸ் ஓல்டு கம்மிங் வித் பெயின் எக்ஸ்ரே எடுத்து பார்த்தா எவ்ரிபடி வாஸ் ஷாக்ட் ஐ பிரசன்ட் இட் ஆர்த்ரைடிஸ் எவ்ரிபடி அக்செப்டட் பைலேட்ரல் ஹிப் கேஸ் இட் வாஸ் எ டிடிஹெச் வென்ட் ஃபார் ஆர்த்ரைடிஸ் டிடிஹெச் வந்து ஃபால்ஸ் அசிடபுலம்ல போய் ஆர்த்ரைடிஸ் ஃபார்ம் ஆயிருக்கு அதுல வந்து 45 இயர்ஸ்ல வந்து பேஷண்ட் இருக்கும் சோ பேஷண்ட் வந்து கிவிங் சிம்டம்ஸ் ஃபார் ஒன்லி 2 இயர்ஸ் அந்த பேஷண்ட் சோ எக்ஸாம்ல டோன்ட் திங்க் தட் இஃப் இட் இஸ் அன் அடல்ட் பேஷண்ட் இட் கேனாட் பி டிடிஹெச் நத்திங் லைக் தட் பட் அந்த டெலஸ்கோபி அண்ட் இது மனோஜ் அடல்ட் பேஷண்ட்ல வந்து ஹவு யூஸ்ஃபுல் இஸ் டெலஸ்கோபி இன் டயக்னோசிங் டிடிஹெச்
சார் அப் டு அடலசன்ட் ஏஜ் குரூப் மட்டும் தான் சார் நான் இப்போ பார்த்தேன் சார் ஸோ அடல்ட் ஏஜ் குரூப் வந்து கம்ப்ளீட்டாக அந்த டாபிக் ஒன்றும் போகல சார் நம்ம அன்ஸ்டேபிள் லிப்பில் பொறுத்த வரைக்கும் எனிவே கண்டிப்பாக வந்து டிடிஹெச் பேஷண்ட்ஸு போஸ்ட் செப்டிக்ஸ் சீக்வெல்லாம் வச்சாங்கன்னா டெலஸ்கோபி இஸ் டெஃபினெட்லி யூஸ்ஃபுல் சார் That is the only finding which is going to cleanse the diagnosis, sir.
Venkatesh, line la irukkiya?
Yes, sir.
Ipo DDH vandu nee present pannumbodhu eppadi pa present pannuva as anatomical, what is the anatomical diagnosis that you will present DDH? What is the anatomical diagnosis? Anju anatomical diagnosis na irukudhu namakku.
Yes, sir.
Nee enna present pannuva DDH?
Sir, unstable hip. அக்கம்பனியிங் that side sir it adu vandu extensive shortening irundhuchu sir but the telescopy was negative in that case sir there is no mm-hmm. telescopy mm-hmm. patient was 23 years old female sir so adu unstable avum illa sir she was able to walk
illa ni enna solla var meningomyelosis nu solla varriya illa ddh irundhuchu nu solla varriya
sir ddh irundhuchu sir but unstable ah vandu late ah varumbodhu nammalku appadi present agadhu illa sir
ella case la present agadhu
False acetabulum form aayiruchuna it won't be unstable is it?
So then you cannot say it is DDH. So your diagnosis clinically will be something different. Puridha? So exam la adult DDH vanduchuna it is little confusing. That's what the point is. Children la DDH nama case romba namakku varum. Of course ICH la eduthittu vandruvom. Suppose adult case or DDH with arthritis andha mari present pannuchu appadina you make sure that the anatomical diagnosis that you are going to give will correlate with your clinical findings நீ பாட்டுக்கு எக்ஸ்ரே பார்த்துட்டு டிடிஹெச் நீ அங்க பிரசன்ட் பண்ணி அங்க டெலஸ்கோப்பியும் இல்ல எக்ஸாஜரேட்டட் மூவ்மெண்ட்ஸும் இல்ல அப்படினா then the examiner will clearly know that somebody has given you the clue so அது வந்து ஆர்த்ரைட்டிஸ் தான் பிரசன்ட் பண்ணனும் அந்த டைம்ல ஏன்னா ஆர்த்ரைட்டிஸ் வந்துச்சுனா ஆர்த்ரைட்டிஸ் தான் பிரசன்ட் பண்ணனும் so you make sure that is in the discussion is only for that so கண்ண மூடிட்டு நீங்க பாட்டுக்கு டிடிஹெச் எக்ஸ்ரே பார்த்துட்டேன் அங்க போய் எக்ஸ்ரே பார்க்கல சார் ஆனா டிடிஹெச் னு சொன்னீங்கனா கண்டிப்பா நம்ப மாட்டாங்க So you make sure that your clinical points yeah Manoj yes
that one point sir adha ipa presentation pannumbodhe solirundha sir actually vandu if it is a high riding dislocation the degenerative changes if it lies in a false acetabulum it will take time for the degeneration changes to appear sir because like true acetabulum there is a false acetabulum formed and femoral head is well seated in the false acetabulum so the patient if he has a bilateral false acetabulum and DDH he definitely degenerative changes appearing in that patient will be very late sir as neenga sonna mari or example neenga sollinga sir ipo or x-ray kaamichinga or 30 35 years old male he presented with just hip pain look like an arthritis telescopy pannumbodhu mattum na DDH mari therinjadhu after seeing the x-ray so that is a high possibility there where dislocated hip high riding hip will present with degenerative changes very late இதே வந்து சப்ளக்சேட்டபிள் ஹிப் வேர் தி ட்ரூ அசடாபுலம் இஸ் தேர் ஃபெமரல் லெட் இஸ் ஜஸ்ட் லேட்டரலைஸ்டு ஓவர் தி ட்ரூ அசடாபுலம் அந்த மாதிரி கேசஸ்ல தி டீஜெனரேட்டிவ் சேஞ்சஸ் வில் அப்பியர் வெரி சூன் சார் possibility of unstable hip possibility of teratological dislocation of hip irukkuradhukku vaipu irukku sir that will be that presentation and the treatment ku appuram konja kadasiya solla poran sir adhu sir varum
okay